highest penalty public cleanliness offences, Amendment Bill 2015. We now resume the second reading debate on the Property Management Services Bill. Honourable Tony Chair, Chairman of the Bills Committee on the above bill, will address the Council on the Committee's report. Honourable Tony Chair. Thank you, Mr. President. As the Chairman of the Bills Committee on the Property Management Services Bill, I would like to report on the deliberations of the Bills Committee. The bill seeks to regulate and control the provision of property management services by establishing the Property Management Services Authority, PMSA for short, and introducing a licensing regime for property management companies, PMCs, and property management practitioners, PMPs. The Bills Committee has held a total of 17 meetings with the administration. It has also received oral representations from the organizations and individuals who are interested. The main areas covered in the deliberation include a single-tier licensing regime for the PMCs, a two-tier licensing regime for PMPs, exceptions to the prohibition of unlicensed activities, transitional arrangements, procedures for license applications and license renewal applications, as well as the functions and powers of the PMSA. The bill provides for a single-tier licensing regime for PMCs. Some deputations from the trade have expressed their views to the Bills Committee that this will drive the small and medium-sized PMCs out of the market, resulting in the monopoly of the market by large PMCs. Sharing these deputations' concern and considering that there are different types of properties in the market requiring different types of property management service, some members have inquired about the administration's rationale for not adopting a multi-tier licensing regime for PMCs. The administration has advised that, in its view, a multi-tier licensing regime will create or reinforce a labeling effect. It will also create restrictions on the types of developments that the small to medium-sized PMCs may serve, which may, in turn, reduce the scope of business for these companies. The administration has pointed out that under clause 13(1) and 2, PMSA must keep a PMC register, which will be made available at the offices of the PMSA and on the internet for public reference. A single-tier licensing regime for PMCs, supported by the availability of transparent information, is the best option as it strikes a balance between providing a level playing field to the PMCs of different sizes and facilitating consumers in making informed choices. For the practitioners, the bill provides for a two-tier licensing regime of PMPs, namely PMP Tier 1 and PMP Tier 2, that is the registered property manager as well as the licensed property management officer. The administration has stressed that only an individual who assumes a supervisory or managerial role in a property management services company will be subject to the licensing requirement. Frontline staff will not be required to obtain PMP licenses. The Bills Committee has requested the administration to elaborate what constitutes a managerial or supervisory role. According to the administration, its preliminary thinking is that in applying for a PMC license, a PMC should submit its organization charge to PMSA. The authority would then specify in the license as licensing conditions which post holders should hold PMP Tier 1 or PMP Tier 2 licenses, having regard to the optimal ratio of the number of licensed PMP Tier 1 and licensed PMP Tier 2 to the management portfolio of PMC, for example, the number of flats or area to be managed. Employees filling posts requiring a license should have the respective tier of licenses. Members have expressed particular concerns about the employment prospects of the experienced in-service practitioners who have not received formal training. some members also shared the deputation's view that the administration should consider adopting the grandfathering arrangement and issuing permanent PMP licenses to experienced in-service PMPs without requiring them to obtain the required academic qualifications or to complete the relevant continuing professional development CPD courses. The administration has stressed that it is not the intention of the administration to set a high threshold for the issuing of PMP licenses, thereby undermining the employment opportunities of existing PMPs. Experienced PMPs who do not satisfy all the licensing requirements, for example, academic qualifications, will be issued provisional licenses if they can meet certain basic requirements, for example, years of working experience during the three-year transitional period. After they have obtained the provisional licenses, they will be allowed 3 years to complete the necessary CPD courses recognized by PMSA so that they can be issued formal licenses upon the expiry of their provisional licenses. For those PMPs who have met the licensing criteria of formal licenses, they may apply for formal licenses directly during the three-year transitional period. Members note that the bill provides for exceptions to the prohibition of unlicensed activities. For example, if an owner's organization has not engaged a PMC or a PMP to provide property management services, then the licensing requirements do not apply to such an owner's organization. Equally, if the owners of a building have not engaged a PMC or PMPs to provide property management services for their building, then the owners will not be subject to the licensing requirements. Members and some deputations have expressed their concern that such arrangements may create loopholes. Some members opine that if an OC decides to switch from engaging a PMC to self-management, such a decision should be supported by the passage of a resolution at a general meeting of the OC so as to prevent any attempt to circumvent the licensing regime. Having further considered members' views, the administration has agreed that it will move ACSA to add a new clause, or rather a new subclause 4A to clause 7, to the effect that if the owner's organization of a property ceases to engage a PMC or PMP, the exemption does not apply unless the cessation is approved by a resolution passed at a general meeting of the owner's organization. Some members have expressed concern that the management standard of self-management buildings or estates may not be satisfactory if the number of property units in such buildings or estates is very large. Sharing the view of some deputations, some members have suggested that the administration should set a limit on the maximum number of property units that can be managed by an exempted owner's organization. The administration has agreed to propose a CSA to add new subclause 4B under clause 7 to specify that owners' organizations or owners cannot self-manage properties that contain 1,500 or more than 1,500 flats within the meaning of Section 2 of the Building Management Ordinance. Members have also expressed concern that the bill, as presently drafted, will require non-profit making or charitable organizations and members' offices which provide free advisory service or legal advice to owners' organizations to obtain a PMC license. In the light of members' concerns, the administration will move its SA to stipulate that a person is not prohibited from providing advisory services relating to property management services without consideration. As to disciplinary action, a member has said that the administration should make it a mandatory requirement for all licensed PMCs and PMPs to fulfill the statutory requirements under BMO and to observe and follow the relevant codes of practice and the best practice guides on building management. The administration has pointed out that the Lands Tribunal has jurisdiction over the proceedings relating to the interpretation of the provisions in BMO and DMCs. Therefore, PMSA does not have the power to determine whether a licensee contravenes BMO or a DMC, nor to issue any code of conduct for that purpose. After further consideration of the members' proposal, the administration agrees to move a CSA to provide that a licensee commits a disciplinary offence if the court determines that the licensee has contravened a requirement in the BMO or a DMC that is applicable to the licensee. Some members would like to put in place a mechanism so that PMCs may report to PMSA of any cases of violating acts under the BMO committed under pressure from the OC or non-compliance with the codes of conduct to be issued by the PMSA. The administration agrees with the members' view and advised that these matters will be addressed in the administrative guidelines to be issued by PMSA. The administration will also move CSAs to enhance the license renewal procedures. If the PMSA does not receive renewal application from a PMC within the stipulated time frame, it will proactively inform the owners or owners' organizations of the property managed by the PMC concerned. In addition, for those PMCs whose license renewal applications are rejected, PMSA can extend the validity of the license for a period not exceeding 6 months. PMCs can continue to provide services to existing owners and owners' organizations such that they will have sufficient time to hire a new service provider. Under Clause 3, PMSA may, by regulation, prescribe a service falling within a category of services set out in Schedule 1 to the Bill as a property management service. Under that regulation, PMSA may provide for more than one type of service under the category. If a PMC only provides one category of services or one type of service under a category of services, there is no need to obtain a license. Regarding the seven categories of property management services set out in Schedule 1, members are concerned about how each defined category of services will be further subdivided. The administration has explained to the Bills Committee that Schedule 1 to the Bill has been modeled on the specification of competency standards for property management industry of the Hong Kong Qualifications Framework. The preliminary thought of the administration is that only management of the environment of a property will be divided into four subcategories, namely, cleanliness of common types of or common parts of buildings, landscape design and maintenance, environmental protection and security and fire safety. In response to members' requests, the administration has provided details of the expected services within each category. Furthermore, taking into account the number of items of subsidiary legislation to be introduced, members have urged the administration that the draft subsidiary legislation relating to the bill should be made available to the panel on home affairs as early as possible for consideration. The administration has undertaken to do so in batches, and this will be done as soon as possible so as to consult the Home Affairs Panel. Mr. President, we've also noted that the administration will be moving some textual amendments to the bill. The Bills Committee does not object to such CSAs to be moved by the administration later on. Mr. President, so I've just reported on the deliberations of the Bills Committee. Now I will turn to my personal comments. Mr. President, before I was elected as a legislative member, I spent most of my time in real estate-related business. So I have had some understanding about property management services in Hong Kong. I also support the effort to turn the industry into a more professional sector. As a result of the filibustering by some colleagues, it has been deferred until today to resume the second reading debate. Yes, it is later than it was originally scheduled, but still, we are able to complete the scrutiny and deliberation of the bill within this session so that we can enact a new law and then we can enter a new phase. For property management services in Hong Kong, all along, we don't have a standard to regulate the companies as well as the professionals or the practitioners. On the other hand, for our neighboring cities, they have all got a relevant licensing regime. Therefore, in Hong Kong, we have been lagging behind. Now, livelihood issues have attracted more and more public attention, and in fact, the community has got higher and higher expectations of property management services. We've got the mandatory window inspection and mandatory building maintenance programs. So PMCs are assuming a more and more important role. It is but right to have a licensing regime so as to enhance the standards of the industry. This will also facilitate the further development of the industry. Therefore, I support the bill. Now, the bill is going to have far-reaching effects on the companies as well as the practitioners. In order to enable the companies and the practitioners to have a better understanding of the bill, I've invited representatives of the relevant companies and professional bodies to form a working group so as to focus their attention. In addition, I have organized and I've attended the relevant seminars so that we can receive comments from the industry and the community at large via different channels concerning this bill so as to reflect the comments to the administration. We hope that we get a piece of legislation that can take on board the various aspirations of the stakeholders. For the bill, I've got the following comments to make. For the licensing regime, well, I've made inquiries with the administration. I've been told that as to the number of practitioners and also for those that can meet the licensing requirement, there is Tier 1 as well as Tier 2 PMP licenses. I would like to know about the number of individuals involved, and I want to find out whether there will be sufficient qualified manpower to deliver the service upon commencement of the bill. Now, I've been told that currently we haven't got a mandatory licensing regime. Therefore, at this stage, it will be impossible to provide an accurate assessment concerning the manpower. And therefore, again, the government cannot have breakdown information about the qualifications of the practitioners. In 2013, there was a survey carried out by a professional body, that is the housing managers. About 4,000 people should qualify for Tier 1 PMP, and then another 7,500 should qualify as PMP Tier 2. In relation to the administration's reply, I'm disappointed. So I query as to why we are not using this opportunity to provide adequate resources to carry out a relevant survey. In this way, we can make better preparation for the work, and we can have a stronger rationale. And then we can also have a long-term plan for the future development of the industry. Now, for the bill, I understand that there will be a single-tier licensing regime for PMCs. If you only provide one category of service, like security, etc., then the company will not be bound by the licensing regime. There are seven categories of services. I believe that we need to improve the definition of the scope of the categories. Property management services require professional knowledge, and it entails a high degree of diversity. Well, companies do differ one from another. A company may provide cleansing service to the proper area of a housing estate, or the glass curtain, the external wall, or clearing the gutters and providing recycling service as well. So I hope the administration will come up with clearer definitions and clearer guidelines as to define the scope of property management services. Moreover, the government must make sure that the companies are financially sound and have proper organizational structures before they are licensed. In addition, we should also consider the need of PMCs to employ a specified number of PMPs, and the number of PMPs mandated should echo the scale of the business of the PMCs. Yes, there will be subsidiary legislation to cover such matters. I still hope that I can ask the administration to give us the details as early as possible so as to arrive at a consensus among the stakeholders. Now, for the two-tier licensing system for PMPs, I understand that when you are assuming a supervisory or managerial role, then you need to get a license. Frontline staff will not be required to obtain PMP licenses. In principle, for this provision, I do not query, but I believe that the administration must provide details as to what is meant by a supervisory role, what is meant by a managerial role, so as to remove the worries of the practitioners. Mr. President, as far as the licensing fees are concerned, it is expected that it will be $6,000 for a PMC, and then for a PMP Tier 1 license, it will be about $1,200 a year, and then for a PMP Tier 2, it will be about $400 per year. I believe that such levels are acceptable. However, for the PMP licensees, they need to study a course to get qualified, or they need to take out CPD courses. That will be a burden on them, and also it means that the companies will have to pay more for the PMPs, and at the end of the day, the burden will be shifted to small landlords. So I hope that we can provide some kind of subsidies to their PMPs for their studies. Of course, the licensing regime will enhance the image of the professionals. We have got also incumbent practitioners who are very experienced, and yet they do not have the academic qualifications. So it is a matter of concern that they may lose their rice bowls. Therefore, we have been told by the administration that there will be a 3-year transitional period. The PMPs who are experienced but not academically qualified can provide documents to get grandfathering treatment. If they meet the requirements, they will still get a license. The government has been responsive, and the government has been adopting a pragmatic and practical attitude. I do welcome such an approach. Now, the PMSA we'll have a chairman, vice chairman, and no more than 18 members. I understand that non-industry members will be the majority. Someone in the industry has said that there will be investigations into complaints and appealable matters have to be attended to. So it is believed that the membership should have a majority of industry practitioners. So they have asked for a higher ratio of members coming from the property management services, so that those who are the subjects of appeal and investigations will be given unbiased treatment. I hope that when the administration is to appoint members to the PMSA, please find somebody who has some knowledge about property management services. Otherwise, it will be non-professionals leading the layman, rather than non-professionals taking the lead. And I understand that We have got a self-financing model for the PMSA. One-third of the revenue will come from the license fees. For the rest, I think it will come from a levy for the conveyancing of immovable property. I hope that the PMSA will have a reasonable degree of administrative efficiency so that the licensing fees will be kept at a reasonable level. Lastly, Mr. President, I would like to express my gratitude towards the members of the Bills Committee as well as the Secretariat for their hard work so that the deliberation of the bill can be carried out smoothly and completed satisfactorily. Mr. President, so I speak and I say once again that I support the bill as well as the various CSAs to be moved by the administration. Thank you.
Mr. Wong Kwok-hing. Mr. President, good afternoon. Of my 12 years in this council, today is one of the happiest days for me because I finally see this property management services bill being scrutinized by the council today. In terms of protecting the interests of small property owners, this bill represents a milestone. Mr. President, to strive for the enactment of this bill, back in 2005, when there was an amendment exercise to the Property Management Ordinance, at that meeting, I spoke and that was what I said. The administration should set up a licensing regime for property management companies. There should be regulation overseeing PMCs with a penalty system so as to protect the interest of property owners. And yet, it wasn't translated into action until the last Secretary for Home Affairs, Mr. Cheng Tak-sing, assumed office. I spoke to him once again, and then the policy was established, and then discussions and studies, person to policy formulation were initiated. So I thank Mr. Cheng Tak-sing for taking us to the progress that we see today. And Mr. President, I'd like to ask you to relay my gratitude to Mr. Cheng Tak-sing. And I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank the owners' corporations of over 100 buildings in North Point and also the OC, the members of the OC of the Providence Center in North Point, and the support of residents in 1,450 units in 17 blocks. Is there support that we see this bill as a small property owner, as chairman of the Owners Corporation of the Providence Garden in North Point? We were oppressed by the developer because because Providence Center then wanted to change the property management company, and we were sued for libel by the developer. Queen's Council was engaged. The 17 members of the OC were sued. As chairman of the DAB, Mr. President, back then we asked you to intervene, but in the end, as chairman of the OC, as a district councillor, together with the 16 members of the OC, we had no alternative but to write a letter of apology to be sent to the mailboxes of the 1,450 units in the center, and even the legal advisors were also sued for libel. So you see, the property developer behind the property management company's attempt to oppress individual owners. There was no way for individual owners to complain. And frankly speaking, even if I sold the flat, I wouldn't be able to cover the legal costs for the libel case. Fortunately, owners of the Providence Center supported us. They trusted us. Even after we publicly sent letters of apology to them, during the election, during the next election, we were elected. And once again, I felt the oppression. I fully understood the helplessness of individual owners in Hong Kong. So after I joined the Legislative Council, I strive to protect the interests of property owners. There should be legislation to protect them, because the original property management ordinance could not provide any protection, or rather the building management ordinance. Why is it that PMCs and PMPs are not subject to any regulation? It is absolutely unreasonable. So this bill is very crucial to protecting the interests and rights of individual owners. It is a very reasonable bill. I have 6 points to make. First, as some members of the public have said, why is it that even for caretakers, they need to get a license, but not PMPs and PMCs? Second, for most PMCs in Hong Kong, they are actually subsidiary companies of property developers. After a developer complete the development project, after the property is sold, the property developer would then set up a PMC to extend its vested interest and to undermine the rights of individual owners. Without legal the legislation, we do not get any protection. Third, no channel of complaint. Well, I had this experience. I helped owners and of over 100 buildings in North Point and their OCs, but not a single government department could take our complaint. Because of the lack of legislation, even the Consumer Council could not do anything about it. But today, we finally see this bill. Fourth, I think that although the bill has been tabled, it is a bit too late, because the administration has failed to understand that individual owners are not adequately protected. And I'm not referring to just this administration, but previous administrations. They failed to see the problem. This is an error. If you talk about deep-seated conflicts, then this is one of them. Fifth, for PMCs, if you don't have a property management services authority, it is difficult to manage or to regulate the PMCs, because these major PMCs are in fact subsidiaries of major developers, or they are established by or incorporated by the property developers. Now, it is very difficult to for owners to have a say in the management expenses. And also, it's difficult or impossible for individual owners to set up their own OCs. Now, I can't name all the buildings now, but these buildings are subject to the manipulation of property developers. Individual owners can't set up their own OCs. So from these 6 points, we can see that this bill is an important milestone in terms of offering legal protection to the interest of individual owners. Now, I understand that this is only the principal ordinance. We still need to scrutinize the subsidiary legislation, the inadequacies in this bill. Hopefully can be addressed in the subsidiary legislation exercise. We'll follow up on these issues, but I'm afraid that it will be in the next term of the Legislative Council. I, however, need to take this opportunity to make this clear. Any member who remains in the Council next term should follow up on protecting the interest of property owners. There are 6 aspects which are of our concern during the deliberations. First, on protecting the jobs of incumbent PMPs. One of the affiliated or subsidiary associations of the FTU, the the practitioner of the association says that the interests of serving practitioners should be protected, and the administration has replied that there will be a 3-year transitional arrangement together with a 3-year exemption period. We welcome that, but without standard working hours, the requirement for continuous professional development is nothing but talk shop. For Tier 1 PMP, the original intent is that it should be the PMP should be a member of a professional body or institute. But we have a different view. As long as there is sufficient academic qualifications or work experience, they should be allowed to be registered, because some of the membership fees of these professional institutes or professional bodies are too high. Must they become members of these institutes before they can be allowed to be registered? It is not reasonable. Now, about the fees, the administration has said that the license fee is ranging from 400 to 1200, but we believe that it is too expensive. I think the administration should seriously consider capping it at $400 instead of 1200. Point number 4, composition of the PMSA, Property Management Services Authority. In the course of deliberations, I reflected the strong views of the practitioners and labor's union. We think that they should be represented in the authority. Although these members would be appointed in their personal capacity, we note, however, that the composition of the proposed PMSA, and we question whether it is impartial and fair, and whether it will be biased in favor of the interest of property developers. I have been engaging in council work for decades, and I understand absolutely clearly the influence of property developers. So without labor union representatives or practitioners as representatives in the authority, I find it unacceptable. Point number five, on the investigation power of the authority, the administration should consider whether it is impartial, whether it is fair and just, without any conflict of interest. Point number six, the bill. After passing the bill, we need to enact subsidiary legislation. So in the drafting stage, Secretary should seek the views of frontline workers, labor unions, and small owners. I hope that the bill can protect the interests of individual owners.
Mr. Chiang Kok-chee, we are now scrutinizing the Property Management Services Bill. We want to improve the quality of management of buildings. So we are going to set up the PSMA. After that is done, there will be a single-tier licensing regime, and no unlicensed PMCs will be allowed, and we will also be dealing with disciplinary offenses. The PMSA will have the power to impose sanctions and to deal with disciplinary matters. I support doing this to improve property management. As I said in a seminar, property investment represent a big part of the owner's investment. So it's important to ensure that property management should be of high quality. If there is a proper management with the establishment of an authority, the property management companies should be able to do its job properly and assist the owners in upgrading and maintaining the property, and also to properly deal with the finances of building management. We hope that from now on, there will be a proper address systems to deal with unscrupulous PMCs, and owners will not be forced to accept poor services, and they will be better protected. The bill also improve the service quality of property management practitioners. There will be two tier. First tier property management managers. They have to hold a degree, and then the second tier, the licensed property management officers. They don't have to have a degree. In 2013, the training board on property management practitioners conducted a survey, and altogether 110,000 people are employed on the property management services, and 60% of them are on management and maintenance, and there's a shortage of 5 or 10% of frontline practitioners. Annually, we need 500 to 600 new graduates to join the industry. And also, with the there are other policies to implement, such as prevention of lead in water, levy on waste, and they would need the service provided by the property management officers. And in 2017 to 2019, we are going to see the peak of housing supply of new housing units. We need more PMPs. and the government should raise the overall standard and the credibility of the industry. There should be a proper progression ladder for practitioners so that the property owners have more confidence and have access to a stable and quality service system. I have some worries about the licensing of PMPs, about the system of licensing PMPs. There are experienced practitioners who don't lack the qualification required. There will be a 3-year transitional period, and the government will also cooperate with training institutions to train up sufficient number of people. And experienced PMPs can submit visas or a report to take the place of attending property management training courses. But we're still concerned that these experienced PMPs will lose their jobs after the licensing system is introduced. They have decades of working on property management. They are doing the job of handling different matters related to housing management, such as environmental protection, cleansing, hygiene, catering, and different property are served by these people. Decades ago, we did not have the universal free education, so people back then did not get much education. They started work at a young age and they could not return to school. So they might be holding lower education qualifications, but we have to thank them for the quality of life and the convenience that comes with economic prosperity. So that's what they are the reason why we are enjoying good property management services. It would be difficult for them to return to school now. And even for the one-off assessment, such as a presentation of a thesis or a report to take the place of a qualification assessment, it might still be a bit difficult for them. I urge the government to reconsider, in the context of the licensing system, the case of the experienced practitioners, so that their livelihood will not be affected, because they have the experience to deal with the relevant rules and guidelines. I hope there will be a one-off exemption granted to these quality, experienced property management practitioners, so that their service will still be made available. We don't want to see a brain drain of experienced practitioners. Take the social welfare sector as an example. We started to consider the licensing of social workers in the 1970s. In the mid-80s, there was a voluntary registration system in place. And in 1997, the Legislative Council passed the bill on the registration of social workers. At the time, there were social workers who have been serving in the sector for decades, and they have been working faithfully to serve their clients and our community. But many social workers did not hold the requisite qualifications, and the social welfare sector's proposal was accepted. And in that, for social workers who had more than 10 years or more experience will be registered as social workers, provided that the service prior to registration have been unbroken. And if they leave the social welfare sector and want to join subsequently, they will be subject to the qualification requirement. So these experienced social workers have been doing a very good job since then. The government will require the PMPs to complete all the relevant training courses within 3 years to be to register as a PMP. I hope the government will consider relaxing the requirements on these experienced practitioners. We've been talking about licensing of PMPs and property management companies for years. And we have asked for a building management panel. Now, under this bill, we are going to have the regulatory system and the PMSA, but the government has got nothing to offer for the buildings appeals panel. And the government has also said that this bill is not related to bid rigging of building repair maintenance. Property owners are responsible for the repair maintenance of their buildings. The consultative group on building management has got limited powers. We must continue to improve the dispute resolution mechanism for building management problems. I hope the government will learn from the experience of setting up a PMSA and to set up the appeal panel on building management so as to improve the building management system in Hong Kong. I adjourn the meeting until the 13th of April at 11 a.m.